I want to thank you for being early. I think we'll have some latecomers and we can get on them at the end of the presentation. This is the venue where we want to not only learn about assessment and learning, but we want to have a conversation, start a learning circle, and discuss how is it that we can take assessment to the next level. Hopefully through some type of action planning, through proving success models and improving learning for our students here. So I hope that Dr. Joanne Weiss from the University of Phoenix starts that conversation today, and I hope that you feel free to ask questions throughout the presentation and after the presentation so that we can take some type of outcome from the talk today. But Dr. Joanne Weiss is the Senior Director of Assessment at the University of Phoenix, and she shepherds all assessment matters in all the colleges within the University of Phoenix. And she mentioned that she works with 21,000 faculty members. So if we thought we had a tough task with 400 plus faculty members, I totally have to respect working with 21,000. I'm going to turn the attention to you, Dr. Joanne, and I hope everyone has fun today.
Okay? Thank you. I really appreciate the opportunity to come up. I'm a teacher at the K-8 level. That's where I came out of K-8. And so they gave me two microphones, and I thought, oh my gosh, I haven't used a microphone in years. I stood before 800 people, and they at least had to put one on here so that I could, you know, project for 800. But in a room this size, this will be fine. I want to reiterate something that Luis said, which is this really is the beginning of a conversation, and that means that you are as participatory in this conversation as I am. I will reach the point where I'm just going to stop and say, what do you think? Okay? So, please, we're just going to move forward here. I'm going to tell you a little bit about me because I'm supposed to. I have a Doctor of Education in Higher Ed Leadership. My Master's is in Curriculum Instruction, and I have a BA in Sociology. How I went from one to the other is a very long story, so I'm not even going to go there. But the reason that I think I've known Alice, I met her last 2 years ago?
2012.
We were both in WASC's Assessment Leadership Academy, and so it's a pleasure to come and to see her again. We haven't been able to chat in a few years. My experience is in a number of areas. Program design, really important for assessment. Hi.
Hi, how are you doing?
Good, thank you.
I apologize for my being late.
Oh, that's okay. I'll just call you out. So program design, also curriculum design, instructional design, and who else am I? Institutional effectiveness, and last of but not least, assessment. So those are my areas of experience. I actually worked for an institution here in California called Fresno Pacific University, which is in Fresno, and I was the associate dean for institutional effectiveness there, and had the responsibility of putting in place an assessment practice both at the curricular and the co-curricular levels. We'll talk about that a little bit. I have been in the classroom, yes, since I was at my little munchkins in the 7th and 8th grade, but online. I've taught online since 2007, and I have taught on the ground as well. I've developed courses. I have been ranked. I'm ranked as an associate professor of education, and it's great fun to do all of that. I've had the pleasure, actually, of being able to work with teachers since my associate professorship is in education. It is, I teach teachers how to teach. I think that's the best way to do that. All right. And that is about mentoring and also about faculty peer review, which is a very interesting way to have to evaluate and work with one's peers. I am a member of the American Association of Learning in Higher Education, their Assessment of Learning in Higher Education, the Association of Institutional Research, and Kappa Delta Pi, as well as doing some consulting both domestically and internationally, and that's been great fun. Okay, so I want to tell you a little bit about U of P, because U of P, I just want to put it out there. U of P is the largest institution in the world. It's the gorilla in the room. It has a target on its back all the time. That's okay, but I do want to remind you that it's the largest institution in the world for a reason, because it does really well at what it does, which is adult education. We have an average student age of 33, and our students, there are 255,000 of them. We have 70 some odd campuses all across the United States, Canada, Asia, and Europe. And it has, as I said, 21,000 faculty, bless their hearts, and 850,000 alumni. So I need you to get your mind for a second around that scale. Okay? It's a really big institution. Really big. I went from Fresno Pacific, which was 4,000 students, to 255,000 students. Uh-huh. A great fun. Okay. There are 9 colleges and schools at the University of Phoenix. Education, health services, business, a number of other ones. Very, very career-oriented institutions. We do have a College of Humanities and Sciences, and we do have a College of Social Sciences. They happen to be a little bit smaller. It might amaze you to know that our Master's of Business Administration has 45,000 students, one program, in one college. Okay, just want you to know. So let me tell you what's going on with University of Phoenix for assessment. There is an Office of Assessment. I'm the senior director of the Office of Assessment. And there are a number of things that we are involved in. I do have an assistant director. I could not live without him because he does a tremendous amount in terms of helping to move things, keep things moved along. I have academic assessment managers. There are 3 of those. And their role is to coordinate the assessment practices in particular colleges and schools. So I have a psychometrician who is one of them, and she works with the colleges that are most concerned about that kind of assessment. They tend to focus on the academic side of the house. There are 9 colleges, so each one of the 3 of them have 3 colleges that they're responsible for. They actually work really closely with assessment deans who are in each one of the colleges. So I've got this group, and then there is U of P is a very matrixed organization. So those 9 assessment deans that actually are solid lined into the academic deans of their colleges are dotted lined to me. Okay? All right. I have a couple of project directors on my team, and the reason for that is because we're in the process of building an assessment management tool. You'll hear a little bit more about that as we move forward today, but these 2 guys are my tech guys, and I've had to sort of step out of that because they are so far down in the weeds that I don't understand their language anymore. Okay. I have a communications manager. And that's because I put out a lot of information, and it's just very helpful to have someone who's doing that. She also has some data analysis background, and works very closely with my research managers. And they do a lot of reporting for me about the different things that are going on inside of our work. For example, we're doing a big research project right now that we've been at for about 6 months. It's on norming and calibration how do you take 21,000 faculty members and norm them around a rubric? Really difficult to do. So we are working at that problem from a research perspective, and they are very involved in that. We do academic assessment. We also are responsible for co-curricular assessment, and so I have a senior assessment manager who focuses on co-curricular assessment. In our world, any department that touches a student, the library, enrollment, financial aid, academic advising, student resource centers, tutoring centers, math centers, all of those, they're considered part of the co-curricular group for our accreditor, which is Higher Learning Commission. And so we have to assess their work. Not only do we assess their processes, but we assess student learning in those departments. When a student goes through a financial aid office, the financial aid office ought to know what it is that they expect their students to learn as they are proceeding through that process. And so we measure that. Okay? All right. The effort also includes Apollo Tech. Apollo is actually Apollo Education Group. They are the parent, if you will, of University of Phoenix. Apollo Education Group has 8 institutions around the world, and U of P happens to be the largest of those, but they are centrally located in Phoenix, and one of the things that they do for all those institutions is statements of work in technology. And so U of P doesn't have its own technology department. We depend upon Apollo Tech to do that. And of course, there are thousands of people in Apollo Tech. We have project managers and product managers who are helping us to build this assessment management tool. There are architects and engineers and some offshore people as well who are involved in this effort to build this system. Of course, there are the faculty. There are 21,000 of them for 255,000 students. We were down to about 200, well, let's say this. We've gone from, at peak, about 450,000 students. And as more and more institutions, yes, isn't that amazing, 450,000 students? As more and more institutions have gotten into the online business, we were it, right? It has gone down, the enrollment has decreased. So we've gotten as low as about 230, we're back up to about 255. They're projecting us to be about 300,000 in about 2 or 3 years. Okay. So, a lot of faculty that we work with. We work with those 9 colleges and schools. There are people, there are the assessment deans, they are the hub of assessment in those individual colleges. They're also subject matter experts in those colleges, and they work with program deans and instructional designers that are centrally based, as well as faculty subject matter experts who actually build courses. Oh yes, and then of course there's executive and academic leadership, and they are the bane of my existence. Bless their hearts, I love them. I am. Yes. So I think there are 72 campuses right now. There are there were as many as 125 at one time, and we have narrowed that down somewhat. And one of the ways, it is nearly impossible for a central office in Phoenix, even as wonderfully talented as the people there are, to actually have their fingers in all of these campuses. So we have created a role that we call Campus Faculty Assessment Liaisons. And that's a CFAL, C-F-A-L. Campus Faculty Assessment Liaisons are local faculty who are contracted to do some additional hours, and they get 125 to 150 hours a year to do assessment work on their campus. And they are the hub for a particular program. So if the campus has a program in psychology that's running on that campus, and there is a cohort of students that's working through that program in that campus, then we ask one of the faculty members to step in as an assessment liaison. And then they are the ones who actually hub all of the assessment work in that campus. There are campus college chairs and lead faculty area chairs at all of these campuses as well. And there are directors of academic affairs and campus directors and everyone. I mean, there it is, I know, it's insidious, actually, the amount of work and people that it requires to do assessment work in an institution our size. But we really had to make that investment because assessment is, it's about student success. We have to be able to prove that students are learning, and that's what it is really all about. Okay, what else do I need you to know? So curriculum and content services is it is another group that does work in the assessment area, and there's a group that's called Learning Tools. They are the ones who work in our LMS, which we affectionately call Classroom. So any questions on U of P structure?
The Apollo Tech is the database system?
Apollo Tech is the group that is responsible to provide the technology for us to do our work.
And what is your assessment management tool?
We are going to talk about that. That is the crux of our work. Okay, so I want to talk for a few minutes about what is driving assessment for University of Phoenix. And what I actually think should drive assessment for any institution that is concerned about student success. First thing is that assessment has to be integral to teaching and learning. It is so intertwined with the concept of teaching, that's the faculty, learning, that's the student, and assessment comes either formatively or summatively within that course. It is about student success. I did teach mathematics at one time on the elementary level, and so this is my throwback. Assessment has to be m squared s cubed. M. It has to be meaningful. If we give busy work to our students to measure their learning, it's meaningless, right? So we want to make sure that whatever assessment we craft is actually relevant to what has occurred in that class. And so we have course student learning outcomes, or we have course learning objectives, whatever we happen to call them, doesn't matter, but at the course level, really important. And then we tie all of our activities and we build that course around those outcomes. It has to be manageable. And this manageability is an interesting situation for us because we are as big as we are. We really have a very manageable system. Granted, there's a tremendous amount of investment that has been placed into the work that we do, millions and millions of dollars, and I really do get that. We were in a position where we didn't have any choice, right? We have an accreditor that says you have to do X. And so from a compliance point of view, a lot was put in. But there's the flip side of that, and we'll get to that. All right. The system also has to be simple. It cannot be so overwhelming that people can't use it. And so that was important to us. It has to be sustainable. By the way, do you have a 10-year assessment plan? You should. There you go. Because you plan for assessment, especially at the institutional level, you have to plan that years in advance. And then you can actually get systematic about the way that assessment is done at all these individual levels. Third thing, let's say systematic, faculty driven. If faculty are not on board with assessment, it doesn't work. That's it, bottom line. Faculty are the key to learning. They are the key to student success. And if it's about student success, which it's supposed to be, then faculty have to be involved. And faculty are the ones who are gathering the data. They're the ones that are creating those assessments, and they're the ones that are collecting the data, and they're the ones that are analyzing that data, and they're the ones that are changing things in their classrooms as a result of what the data tells us, and they're the ones who are remeasuring. Typical assessment cycle. All right, and so assessment has two purposes. One is internal, and frankly, it is the more important one. Yes, we have an external, accreditors. It's the co-compliance business. And yes, true. But it has to be about the student. And we've got to be finding ways to reach those students better, to ensure that they are learning more deeply than just, say, on the surface. Assessment helps us to do that. And if we do it right, we can be in this mode and develop a culture of continuous improvement over and over and over again. It's about the student, okay? All right, let's see. So, what is outcomes-based assessment of student learning? You see that, let's talk, you're gonna see that occasionally. That's because I'm done talking, time for you to talk. What's outcomes-based assessment of student learning? Anybody know? Want to take a stab? Join me in the conversation. Take a guess.
Or tell the person next to it, then brave enough
to talk. Fine. Tell the person next to you what we're going to sit next to each other. Now you have to talk. What is outcomes-based assessment of student learning?
I read that question. I read it slightly differently than what I think it's asking. So if we have an outcome.
Okay. Okay. Are you ready to share? Gracious me.
Come again?
What is it?
We were brainstorming here. We believe that it might be evaluation based on deliverables.
That's good. That's very good. Evaluation based on deliverables. That works for me. What else? What is outcomes-based assessment of student learning?
We were put together.
You were put together? Okay. Ladies, what do you think?
To be honest, I guess I found that question a bit confusing. What else would it be based on? You know what I mean?
Oh, gracious me. Well, you're sitting here because you have an idea of what outcomes-based assessment of student learning actually might be because you're engaged in it. But I must tell you from my experience, that's a really difficult question.
Well, then I guess the opposite anecdotally is if somebody says, I've been teaching this class for 20 years and I think it went pretty well, so there you go. You know, like most of the students did okay, like just as opposed to something that is based in the evidence from the students.
Learning. So, my, and I think this is a really good point because what you're causing my brain to think about is grades. Yes, ma'am.
All right, so I'll stick my neck out. You're looking for a product that would be an assessment of what you think your course, and this is where I have the problem, because who's going to say what that product should be or project should be? And so who defines the criteria for a quality outcome? But I think probably project or product based in some way.
Good.
Good, good step. Anybody else wish to share? Yes, sir.
Just beauty on what she said is that in the past, I've worked with members of the business community, mm-hmm. and we use them, the business owners and executives, as advisors of what exactly the students need to know, how to do it, mm-hmm. and those were, that was how we came up with the deliverables, and then there's a great impact on how and what is being taught in the classroom, and then we come up with the assessment. And then after we do the assessment, and we talk again with the business community, we reevaluate the entire process, and it's constantly changing.
That key is this is really important. When we evaluate our students' learning, we learn something from that. Then it becomes imperative for us to change what we are doing in order to improve that student learning. Yes, ma'am.
So when I first read that, that was what my first thoughts were. It drives instruction, it informs instruction, yes. and then you modify. But when I reread it, it didn't sound like that's what, why assessment makes a difference, makes sense to me. But outcomes-based says, ask me something different. So the why would be to drive instruction, to inform instruction, and that is a different answer.
Very good. Okay, I'm going to move on unless someone else has anything else they want to contribute. Okie doke. So, this happens to be University of Phoenix's really 100,000 foot assessment cycle, but it's really typical of assessment cycles. One has to plan. We cannot go about assessment in a willy-nilly fashion. Doesn't work that way. And that's why when I ask if you have a 10-year assessment plan, it's because being able to look forward helps to keep us on track. One of the things that I was really blessed to see, Louise directed me toward a website. And there is right up there in the corner. You know, you have an actual assessment cycle. Okay. The second is you got a plan. There's all these documents inside there. It tells you what learning outcomes at the course level you're going to be assessing in given years, and that's all good. Then you have to collect evidence. And that collection of evidence can take many, many different forms. Then you have to analyze the evidence. Unfortunately, in higher ed, typically in higher ed, most institutions get to that point of collecting the evidence, and they take the evidence and they put it up on a shelf and do absolutely nothing with it. Reams and reams and reams of paper sitting in closets, in boxes. That never means anything. That is not where we need to be. We need to be at the place where we take that evidence, we look at it carefully, and we make decisions about what it tells us, and it drives the change that we are going to make at whatever level we're talking about, whether it's the course level or the program level or the institutional level, doesn't matter, drives the change, and then we figure out what improvements are we going to make, and then we actually implement those improvements in step three, and then we go back and we reevaluate and see if that made a difference, what we did. So I wish to challenge you not to get lost at step two. Use the data for something and then document it, and then Alice will have a much easier time with accreditation when it comes time to having documentation for what you have done, right? Really important. Okay, so at UP, we actually evaluate on four levels. We have a set of university learning goals, so at the university level, there are five of those. Last year, by the way, I've only been at UP since August.
So before I arrived, there was some concern that the university learning goals were not driven enough by the disciplines. So they created a set of general education learning outcomes down in the humanities. And I probably wouldn't have gone that way. And in fact, today, our general education and university learning goals committee is under the directive to combine these two things into one set of outcomes at the university level. We also do programmatic student learning outcomes, and we do course level assessment as well. Okay, so university learning goals are the essence of the education. We measure them only at the mastery level of a curriculum map. So in assessment, when you are designing a program before the coursework, there is a set of very important documents that need to be addressed in the design of a program. The program has to have a mission, it has to have a description, right? It has to have learning outcomes. And then it has to have a curriculum map once the coursework is decided on. Curriculum map, down one side, learning outcomes at the program level. Across the top, coursework. And then each learning outcome is introduced, that's an I, reinforced, that's an R, and mastered. That's usually your capstone courses at the end of the program, right? One of the things we don't do in program design is put a mastery level course at the beginning of the program, because why don't we just set our students up to fail, right? We don't do that. Programs come in sequences. Learning outcomes are the same way. When we measure learning outcomes, we measure them according to introduced, reinforced, and mastered. So for our university learning goals, we only measure at the mastery level of the curriculum map. And there are, you can see the five of them there. And we do university learning goals through all of our programs. And we've got certificates, associates, bachelor's, master's, doctoral level, five levels. On each one, learning outcomes, each one lined up with university learning goals, okay? Gen Ed, you'll notice here how discipline specific this is. And actually, I have some very strong faculty voice on this particular committee that developed these. And we are finding, as a result of our assessment practice, that it is really difficult to measure mathematical principles across the board, right? So, for us, general education is considered a program, and we measure general education only on the undergraduate level, undergraduate and, well, certificates, associates, and undergraduate is where we measure our general education learning outcomes. Okay. All right, we're going to talk again. I want you to think about what is a student learning outcome. Talk to your neighbor, and then we'll get some feedback around. What's a learning outcome?
What is a student learning outcome? To me, your outcomes are part of your objectives that drive your course or what you want them to get out of it. And how do you measure that? I know we do letter grades, but for me, I deal with nursing students. Can they perform at the bedside? Can they apply that knowledge to the empirical practical setting? And why do you do it that way?
For me, it's marketing. measurable.
Part of that, our behavior, their takeaway, obviously, is the whole learning process, at the end of the learning process, what can they demonstrate? Can they demonstrate verbally? Can they demonstrate it in writing? How can they demonstrate what they have learned? And I think there's a discipline, like you said, learning discipline requires a lot of behavioral aspects, not just that in writing.
Right, so does mine.
What they have to do.
Kind of that theory or understanding, why do you do it that way?
That's correct.
It's a rational why do you have to do it.
I think the ones that are better designed have that attitude.
So is the difference just one scale between objectives and outcomes?
Objectives are kind of overarching. They're not specific to saying that they can accomplish this specific task. That's the way I design.
For an individual course. Yeah. The course needs to be designed.
But like that would not work well. The CID on history has maybe 12 objectives. You should know, well, they're wrong. You should know something about this, know something about that. But there's this list of topics to cover. That's what they're called, objectives.
Okay. Thank you for this conversation. Let me show you what the literature actually says that a learning outcome is. Okay? Driscoll and Wood indicate that it is a stated expectation of what someone will have learned. Peggy Mackey, wonderful. These, by the way, Amy Driscoll, Swark Wood, Peggy Mackey, Linda Suskey, these people are at the top of the heap when it comes to assessment. They are the gurus for assessment in the United States. Okay? So, Peggy says that statements, learning outcome is a statement that describes what students should be able to demonstrate, represent, or produce based on how and what they have learned. And then Linda says that it is the knowledge, skills, attitudes, and habits of mind that students take with them from a learning experience. Who's the center of this?
Student.
The student. That's right. It's about the student. And it is about their success. Okay. Now, before we go there, I heard lots of smatterings of conversation here. So there are some basic rules about the development of learning outcomes. They have to be measurable. Okay? They start with a verb. They usually reflect levels of cognitive levels, Bloom, right? Mm-hmm. One of the really difficult things is to put an outcome into measurable language. I have a process called teaming. And my assessment managers meet with their assessment deans and their program deans, their instructional designers, those people, and they come together for 3 days and they develop or design the program. A good portion of that time is about making a decision on what are the learning outcomes of that particular program. And they haggle over every single word. Because the words are important. There is a huge difference between list and create. Huge difference, right? Okay. Learning outcomes have to come first. Whether we are talking about that at the course level, or the program level, or the institutional level, they are the thing that ground the course. They are the thing that ground the program.
they also ground the institution. Because they are the essence of what it is that your students are supposed to take with them when they go.
Do you have like a minimum amount of SLOs you have per course?
So here's the rule of thumb in my experience. At the institutional level, 3 to 5. At the program level, 6, 8, maybe. Okay. At the course level, no more than 8 to 10.
What's the minimum?
6.
Years ago, I don't know if it was 10 years, 15, I've been here 38 years, so time sort of is in a dimension of, you know, in the cloud, so to speak. But we were told to give 3 course learning objectives per each course. That's what we were instructed. And we were given a list to select from.
Really?
Yes.
Sorry. It's really important that curriculum maps be at work here in assessment, because courses cannot be built in a silo. And they are in relationship to what happens before and what's going to happen after. What has the student done prior to this course, right? That's your prereqs or whatever you have. And what are they going to need to be prepared for to go on? Because remember, learning is scaffolded. Start here, constructivism, start here, start building, start building, start building. That's why we don't put a student in a mastery level course. We don't put them in a capstone when they arrive, because they're not prepared for that. So part of what we have discovered, actually, we've been doing a very deep dive at U of P into our curriculum. And we found that, in all honesty, it just drives me right up the wall, but we found that courses were being built with no grounding in the program. And faculty who were teaching this course had no idea what was going on in the course previous or the course after. And so they just built a course, picked a few objectives, said, this is what I'm going to do in my course. Had no idea how that fit into the big picture. And I think it does a disservice to students when faculty do not know what is before and after, or the having this more holistic view of what the program is, so that they can build their courses to fit. So every one of those course learning objectives on a syllabus, behind that course learning objective ought to be a parenthesis that has PSLO, program student learning outcome, in parentheses. That way, there's always right there at the fore, not only for the faculty member, but for the student, that they're not taking an isolated class, they're taking some entire thing.
Saying every objective has a corresponding SLO, is that what you're saying?
As much as possible.
Separate ones, or could they be 2 that are like one?
Let's say the course is designed for a single student learning outcome, but it has all kinds of objectives. Mm-hmm. I would say at least half of those objectives have to map back to that learning outcome, or else that learning outcome cannot be measured in that class. Okay, anything else? Learning outcomes. I could really, you know, get on a soapbox about this. Okay, so.
I have a question, John.
Go ahead, Luis.
Go back to the previous slide. When I read those statements, the third one in particular, knowledge, skills, attitudes, and habits of mind. Mm-hmm. And I think of the assessment process, lending itself to get to that, where students acquire some type of skill or a habit of mind. What are some of the best practices that you've come across that permit teachers to achieve that and permits a learner to achieve it as well. So from a teacher's perspective and from a learner's, student's perspective. Because at the end of the day, that's what assessment is trying to get at, right?
It's
the learner to learn something.
Yeah.
And we can look at the learner, what is it that the learner is doing, right? But we also have to look at the teacher. So what are some of the best practices that you've come across that lead to successful outcomes?
Dialogue. A dialogue is the main one. I would say that when we build courses in silos, when faculty do not come together and talk about these things, then we aren't assuring that no matter what class a student goes into, that they're getting that same sort of habit of mind, for example. That's really the number one thing. We, as a society, we've gotten to this place where people sit behind their computers, and there is something to be said for sitting down and talking to each other. So one of the things that I would recommend is that on an annual basis, at least, that when you look at a program, that all of the faculty in that program, no matter what course they're teaching in that program, that those faculty come together and have a conversation about what they expect out of their students in this regard. Yes, ma'am.
When you have programs that have so many adjuncts, it really becomes a challenge. So, I mean, that's...
Does it?
That's what I... So, I mean, what are the app in your system, how does that work? And we have part-time version.
We have a number of things. We have something that is called Phoenix Connect that actually is it's a very active faculty forum online. Different programs have their own pages, if you will, on that. And they bring the faculty together asynchronously. Somebody sort of monitors it all the time, but there's all this conversation that's going on inside. So, synchronous and asynchronous opportunities for people to talk is one way to get around the adjunct. I actually have 99.9% adjuncts. And so we spend a lot of time figuring out how to engage those faculty members. Those faculty, the average level of experience that those faculty bring to the classroom is 21 years in their field. So the faculty member is a CEO of a major corporation coming and teaching an MBA course, right? They're gonna be able to bring that. But that faculty member also has an obligation to communicate with other faculty, even if he's the CEO of a corporation. So best practice is to create the forums where faculty can come together and have a conversation over what's going on in their programs. Even if you have, like in our case, we can drill all the way down to where, so I had 25 courses, 360 faculty members teaching 25 courses. So therefore, for each course, you might have 8 or 10 faculty who can come together in a forum and talk just about that course. Or you can bring those faculty together we have something called general faculty meetings that happen on a regular basis. Each one of our campuses bring the faculty together on a monthly basis. Anyone who wants to come, and they do different things.
It's optional?
Actually, they're adjuncts, and so they get paid to come.
Yeah.
What are you gonna do? Happens. May I move on? Okay. All right, let me tell you a little bit about, I have really bad knees, I'm sorry. So I have to sit down occasionally. Okay, so let me tell you about a decision that we made a year ago or so, that we needed to really rethink the way that we were doing assessment. And we came to a conclusion that when you have that many faculty members and that many students, it's really important to embed assessment into the classroom. It is not, we just do not have a means to call together the faculty, present them with a stack of you know, papers from courses, give them a rubric, and for 5 hours let them sit there and score, you know, 10. We just don't have the means to do that. And actually, it's quite antiquated. No reason. We have an electronic world. Why do we need to, you know, bring everybody together around the table and do that? So so we've decided that for all of our levels of degree, we're going to do something that's called signature assignments and an associated scoring rubric. And this is where I wanted to take you perhaps a little bit beyond what you have been thinking in terms of coursework. So let me define a signature assignment. Y'all teach a course. What's the big assignment at the end of the course? It's a research paper, it's a final exam, it's something, right? It's a big PowerPoint presentation, it's an oral presentation, it's something at the end of that course. And what's the purpose of that assignment? It represents what we call scaffolded learning inside the course. Just like there is scaffolded learning across the program, there's also scaffolded learning across this course. And they have to demonstrate with some artifact, something, at the end of that course. That's the signature assignment. And we ensure that those signature assignments are developed by faculty and by the curriculum teams that are part of it. Because you remember the scale issue, so we're not in a place where 21,000 faculty members can build their own courses. I get that. And so we spend a lot of time with faculty subject matter experts, with curriculum teams, instructional designers, people who actually get people together, build a course. The assignments reflect what we call an IRMA map. Introduced, reinforced, mastered for assessment purposes. And it's a curriculum map, really. That's all it is. And we ensure that these signature assignments are locked down in classroom. Now, classroom is our LMS. Whether you are an online student at U of P or whether a ground student, everybody uses the LMS because that's where all the course material is, syllabus is there, everything is there. And what we wanted to ensure was that we would have valid and reliable data. So we had to make sure that the signature assignment was the same for every section, what you would call a section, we call an instance, of a course. Now, you might have 3 faculty members teaching a particular course. I've got 100 faculty members teaching a course. So they have got to ensure that for that assignment, everybody's using that same assignment. They, in the construction of their syllabus from that course design guide that I described to you earlier, they can do all kinds of formative things. They can you know, mess with their activities. They can't change the learning outcomes of the course, but they can do activities. They can change readings. They can do stuff like that. But that signature assignment, that's it. They have to be aiming for that.
They have to be aiming.
They have to ensure that everything that they're doing across that course is leading to that signature assignment.
And they all have the same assignment?
Just that signature assignment they would all share, but they can pick and choose their activities and the like from a variety, from a menu, if you will, all of which are provided for them in the course design guide from which they build their syllabi.
So are the students receiving feedback throughout the semester in preparation for that assignment?
Of course.
Or do they get the assignment at the end?
No.
And the feedback is, or the analysis that the faculty make is used for the next class?
In a course, when we build a course, we build activities into that course, readings into that course according to the Carnegie unit. We have formative assessments that we do, all of which go into the grade book, right? And then we have this big thing at the end. That's typically how a course is presented. So if a faculty member is doing what we say we are doing, then all of that formative assessment that's going on throughout the course is indeed preparing them for this signature assignment. So they're getting a lot back. Now for us, in that signature assignment, they're going to get back a lot of feedback in the same way that you will sit there and redline a big paper at the end of a course. We will do that just electronically. So students are going to get feedback. I want to talk about this associated scoring rubric. I'm going to show you samples of this, but I want to talk about it to begin with. First of all, it's criterion referenced, which is, it's not norm referenced, it's criterion referenced. And what we do is we take the assignment itself. Come on in.
Hi,
I'm Joanne.
Hi, Joanne. I'm Ann
Winter. Very nice to meet you. We take something called primary trait analysis, and we break the assignment down into its component parts. And we build a rubric for each line of the rubric is about the component, different component parts. And I'll show you what that looks like. We align the lines of the rubric to programmatic student learning outcomes. We align it to general education or university learning goals, depending upon what the what the level of the course is for assessment purposes. But we also have built, because remember it's electronic, so we've built an algorithm behind the lines of the rubric so that the rubric can be used for grading as well. And that way, faculty are not unduly burdened. Assessment is just the normal part of their routine because they're grading a research paper at the end of a course. And the data, then, that comes from every single one of those lines that's been aligned to learning outcomes gets pushed over to TK20. Now, TK20 is the vendor who is building our assessment management tool in conjunction with my project directors in my office and the Apollo Tech team. The assessment management tool takes that. So student uploads their assignment, faculty goes in, there's the rubric, click, 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 fill in, do the feedback. Every time a line opens up and click, there's a box where it opens up so the faculty can write, And then they push this button here and goes over to the gradebook and the data for the lines of the rubric goes over to this, to TK20. Okay, we're going to stop and talk for a second again. Why do you think rubrics are useful for both faculty and for students? So at your tables, I want you to have that conversation, and then we'll call out some reasons why rubrics might be useful here.
Nursing.
Biology.
And you?
Math. So what do you think, ladies and gentlemen? Why does per rubric might be helpful?
Well, it's objective for one thing.
It's what?
It's objective.
It ensures that
we're all making the same standard. Objective. Right, but it's what's there, how do you, yeah.
Yes, it does. And who is that good for besides you?
Grammar, for example.
Certainly for the student, that they can't do whatever it is you want them to do.
Exactly.
So.
So it gives them a really specific, a specific idea of what you, the faculty member, are looking for. Then when you get all these papers in, because you have something to focus on, when you don't get this, it eliminates scoring bias.
It's your standard.
Because now that subjectivity, you know, I like that student, I don't like that student. Let's be honest, it happens, right? Yes, we do.
Go by that, yeah.
Right. All right, so continue. You're on the right track.
I don't know what part two that we have, sometimes I don't know.
He has a perfect answer.
Because I'm the antenna faculty, so I'm not here for them. So, you know, trying to get your mind wrapped around what you think it should be versus what. My struggle is, it's an intellectual struggle, but so if the performance that you're asking of the student, regardless of what.
Use these methods or these, what we've learned in that chapter. Yeah.
And do other teachers teaching other sections of that sort of course use the same paper you all know?
Well, in terms of the programming courses, it's usually one instructor is teaching. You don't have multiple sections. But for our computer literacy course, yes, in that case,
all right. I have heard some great conversation going on here, so I'm going to ask if we could have finishing up the conversation at table and maybe some sharing. So, Anu, pick on you. Go ahead. Tell us, what were your three words? Transparency. To whom?
Transparency to the students.
To the students.
Right? It's all about the students.
What are we really assessing?
Consistency.
Consistency. Yes.
Guidance, right?
Guidance. For whom?
For the students as well. Because the students are, it serves as a guidance system for every assignment.
You have a different issue.
Does. Okay, that's great. Anybody else want to add something from this table?
We had really similar. We talked about consistent guidelines and as a basis for the clarity.
Okay.
And for the teacher as well.
Thank you.
Right? It permits the teacher to ask some type of criteria.
It's hard to engage.
Right. Absolutely. Okay. Would you guys like to add anything to our list of why it is important?
Focus.
What? So describe that. What do you mean by that?
That the instructor is focused on what they need to teach and the student is focused on what they need to learn and take away from the class.
So one of the things that we do with our faculty, so we have a course and the course has this signature assignment and it's coming 6 or 8 weeks away, right? Night one, week one of the course, guess what that faculty member is doing? You're going to have a signature assignment at the end of this course. Here's the rubric that I'm going to be using. Here is all of how the activities that we are going to be doing over this entire class, these formative things, this is how I'm going to get you to the place of being able to do this. So you're very
transparent
in that course. And in that transparency, then the faculty member can't, in the middle of the semester, just go and go off on some tangent, right? Because the last thing in the world you'd want is for a student to come up to you and say, we didn't learn any of this semester. How can I possibly do this? I can't do this, right? Because if it's about student success, you want to set them up for success right from the very beginning of that class. Okay, so here's what the literature says. Stevens and Levi are gurus in the rubric world. Okay? And so, rubrics provide students with timely and effective feedback. When you use a rubric, and that rubric, by the way, the rubric doesn't say does not meet, approaches, meets, and exceeds. It actually defines what you mean. What does it look like when you are not approaching my expectations for you in this particular course? Okay, it prepares students to use detail, it encourages critical thinking among students and faculty, and facilitates communication, and it helps faculty refine our teaching skills because it allows us to really focus, which drives improvement in our own pedagogy. Okay? All right. The other thing it does, and I'm going to be really frank here. We talked about this just momentarily at this one table, but I'm going to be frank with you. We are biased in our scoring. In our grading, we are biased. We bring our own basic biases to the way that we grade our students. And a rubric focuses us in such a way that it keeps us from having to have those little things playing around in our head, you know? Because honestly, they do. And we just should be a lot more transparent about that, right? Okay, so it levels the playing field, which means it puts all the students on the same field. Because you're going to score them all the same way. Okay. So let's talk, we're going to talk about rubrics in detail here. Definition, it is a scoring instrument for evaluating performance along a task, like this is like Stevens and Levi, along a task-specific set of criteria rather than a single numeric score. And here's the other, here's I'm going to be also frank with you. Grades are not an assessment measure. You know why? Because an A to me is different than an A to you. Right? So we can't tell whether students are, there is so much grade inflation in higher ed. Yes, ma'am.
Even if there weren't grade inflation, I work in the Office of Research and Planning, and I can vouch for the fact that there is enormous variability of grading breakdowns between faculty who teach the very same section of the course in the same semester. So even if there wasn't grade inflation, the fact that we have similar students of similar demographics who are getting totally different grading outcomes when they take the class with a different faculty member, like that right there.
I had a student I had a student worker. Okay, and I will, she comes into the office one day, one end of semester. I am so excited. I got an 86 for the class. It was an 86. I got an 86 for the class. I got an A. I said, what? How's that possible? Okay. And the next day, she comes into the class, into office. I got an 85. I got a B. I'm really happy. What? How is it possible that an 86 is an A and 85 is a B? Because in that particular institution, academic freedom dictated that faculty could design their own grade scale. Okay. So, grades. So I get to U of P, it's about September. I am like inundated with stuff. And I get a call from one of my assessment deans in the School of Business, and she says to me, Joanne, I got a call today from something we call business intelligence. These are the people who do like all of the, they do the stats for institutional marker data, like IPEDS and retention and progression, and you know, institutional outcome type stuff. And they want my learning outcomes. they want your learning outcomes. She says, they're asking me for all of my program student learning outcomes. Okay, why? She says, I didn't give them to them. I think you need to talk to them. So, the senior vice president, the vice president, and the director, they're sitting in my office, and they come, and they're like, you know, what do I know? So I hear you want my learning outcomes for all programs. What are you doing with them? Well, we are developing, we've been building a system for a year there where we are going to correlate grades, GPAs, with learning outcomes. I said, and do what with that? Well, we can use that for HLC as accreditation. We can use that as proof of learning. I said, not in my house, you're not doing that. Absolutely not. HLC will have my head if we even go anywhere close to trying to prove student learning with a grade. So please, cease and desist the building of your system. Then I got a call from the provost. Joanne, really? You told them to cease and desist? Yes, I did. That was good. I'm glad you did it. Thank you. Okay. So, point number two. We touched on this just a titch. Where when it provides those who are doing the assessment, that would be us, the faculty members, with exactly the characteristics of the performance level that we should base our judgment on. And it gives the student very clear idea of how they are going to be scored. And rubrics typically are about 4 to 8 lines. So at a nursing program, on a signature assignment, a nursing program, and the program director came to me and said, Joanne, my faculty have built this rubric for this particular signature assignment, this particular course, it's 18 lines long. Really? Can they get it down to about 8? They got it down to 10. That was as far as we could get it. But usually, rubrics are 4 to 8 lines. They usually have 2 to 6 lines of content, and then some line about written communication, and if it's important, like in our place, it's important that they use APA format or they're using MLA format in their writing, whatever it happens to be. And so there's usually some format or style of the discipline. So in the humanities, they want to make sure, especially in psychology, they have to use APA. But, you know, in something else, they might use DeBern or Chicago or whatever. And the rubric doesn't matter because it's the language that's important. And they're developed using primary trait analysis, and I've already told you that we use them for both grading and for assessment. When we build the lines of our rubrics, we want to make sure the language is really clear, that we understand what it is that we're trying to get out of our students for their learning, and that we have clearly identified what that is. We make sure that every line is strategically aligned to either program, you know, these learning outcomes, and we make sure that each line is pre-weighted. The faculty who build these signature assignments, they will assign some value to the line of the rubric. Content, for example, might be worth 30% of those points associated with that assignment, but APA format might be worth 5%. So we don't put the same value on every single line. Right? All right, so I want to show you, this is the template that we've designed. And it has a couple of things. It tells me that there is some. Well, it's supposed to have a pointer, but I don't know how to do that. So, this rubric has a couple of different component parts. If you take off the first and second column, which happens to be the alignment for learning outcomes at the program level or at the institutional level, The rest of it is useful at the course level. We ask them to create whatever the criteria are, and then we use this does not meet, approaches, meets, and exceeds. And for each learning outcome, we ask the faculty to decide what's the criteria for success. Do you want 80% of your students to meet and exceed your expectations? 70%? 85%? Opportunity for conversation among those faculty members. Here's a sample of a signature assignment. Part one, you are the director. Remember, we are career-relevant education for adults who are working. You are the director of nurse education in your hospital. The hospital's human resources department has come and forwarded you statistics showing an unacceptable increase in absenteeism among nurses due to illness in the last quarter. Develop a thematic unit plan around disease prevention and health promotion in the hospital. The unit should consist of 3 one-hour classes, including the following. These are teaching nurses how to teach. So they're developing curriculum for something. This is the actual rubric that goes with that. So you'll see that part one is develop the unit of 3 one-hour classes, including all of these things. So when we get over here to line one of this rubric, at the meets expectation line, this is where you all of the component parts of that 3-hour lesson plans are met. All required components are included for all 3 lessons. They have met the assignment. And then it goes on to give some qualifiers of what that should actually look like. There's a line for written communication down there. Does not meet expectations. Inconsistent grammar, spelling, and paragraphing throughout the paper, and an inability to explain their findings. Surface errors are pervasive enough that they impede communication of meaning. Do you ever have a student hand in a paper like that? Where you have absolutely no idea what they're trying to say? Okay. So on the opposite end, the prose is free of mechanical errors. There's a variety of sentence structures and effective figures of speech. And the writer is clearly in command of standard written academic English. And then what's in between, right? Okay. So this is an example of a rubric. You'll notice that we have aligned, this is it's a master's level course. So there is no general education alignment, but there is alignment to the university learning goals. And there is programmatic assessment over there. On the first end. This happens to be aligned to an MSN programmatic PSLO number 1 and number 2, which, by the way, in the syllabus, way back at the course objectives, remember I told you earlier, behind the objective you put PSLO 1? So from the very beginning of the course, the students know that you're aiming for that particular learning outcome. All aligned from the moment that student walks in, gets that syllabus, knows what their outcomes are going to be, all the way through the activities in the course, into the signature assignment, scored by a rubric that aligns back to what we said it was going to at the beginning of the course. So this is just a picture of what we've done at the moment. We were piloting with 25 courses back in the fall. 5,000 students were part of our assessment practice. Then we have done 122 courses here in the spring. And you'll notice we're up over 25,000 students. 1,400 faculty members are involved. In the fall, coming in the fall collection period, we will put another 200 courses into our system. There will be about 45,000 students that are involved in those 200 courses. And almost 3,000 faculty members. So I said I would tell you a little bit about the assessment management tool itself. It's multifaceted software. It works in conjunction with the learning management system, the rubric functionality of that. It's a consistent approach to assessment documentation. It ensures that we have uniform implementation across all of the colleges and the campuses. Remember, I told you there was like 70 some odd campuses, nine colleges. We can't have everybody at our size. We cannot have everybody doing just whatever they choose. And then it generates reports, and it generates all kinds of things like this. We make sure that we can have an N and a percent for each one of those rubric columns for by course. We're going to look at some course data. By course instance, by rubric criteria, we look at program student learning outcomes, so we can pull that out. We can disaggregate by modality because we are doing both online and ground courses. We can disaggregate by campus, by college or school. We do ethnicity, race, gender, and age. You would not believe the scoring bias around ethnicity and race in the United States. It's huge. And we're also, we have a huge military population, so we want to make sure that we can disaggregate by our military, and we actually break that down by Army, Navy, you know, the different ones. We make sure everybody has a criteria for success, that's a meet and exceed, and then we have all of these up and down aggregation, disaggregation capabilities. Now, I understand that you guys are about to embark with another system of assessment. It's called, what is it called?
TrackDat.
Mm-hmm. TrackDat is an up-and-coming assessment management system. It's catching on to the top three. The top three are TK20, which is the one we're using, and TaskStream. And live text is the third one. TrackDat is coming up it's coming up on those three. It's interesting when you actually go into an electronic system, because then it eliminates all kinds of other things as well, right? Which we'll talk about later. So I want to show you a little bit of a sample. This was a course, this is a Psych 400 course. And this came out of the system. This is at the course level. And this particular assignment was about conflict resolution and peacemaking. And so each of the lines of this rubric has individual criteria. They opted to have one, two, three lines of content. They have quality of written communication, and they have an APA format, right? And so this is 192 students worth of an aggregate, probably 10 or 12 course instances, probably 10 or 11 faculty members. So this is an aggregate report. We also take it all the way down to the individual faculty level. I mean, this aggregate has to come from somewhere, right? So we can actually give the individual faculty member back their information for their course. But this is the kind of report that might be used at the by the dean of faculty in the college, and they would be looking to see how is that course doing. And they would find that, remember we talked about what's that meet and exceed? And so over here on the end, we have essentially a major problem with APA format, because only 66.67% of students are meeting or exceeding our expectations. And in a psychology program where APA is the format, and at a 400 level, this ought to be up in the 90s. So we've got to go back now. This says you got to sit down with the faculty and figure out what is going on across that program, that those students are not getting enough information about APA format and opportunity to write and to use it. These are just some reports that are coming out of the system. We can compare by program student learning outcome. We can compare by demographic. Really interesting in terms of gender or race, ethnicity. When you see information like this, it brings pause to what we're doing. And we can also break down by campus because we have them all over the place, right? We have to be able to disaggregate. And we use all that information for three basic levels of reporting. Every campus has to do programmatic assessment reports. Every college has to do it. And then as an institution, we do that as well. So everything for us from the course level feeds upwards. Okay? So we would like to take a break. That's okay with you. And what do you want to do?
I'd say a good 10 minutes.
And so we'll see you in about 10 minutes.